Welcome back to the Asia Economic Dialogue 2021. I extend a warm welcome to all of you for our seventh session. The theme of this session is India as a Global Partner. This session will be chaired by Mr. Pramit Pal Chaudhary, who is the foreign editor for the Hindustan Times, based in New Delhi, and has been with the paper since the year 2000. He wrote about international politics and economics issues for The Telegraph and The Statesman newspapers in Calcutta from 1985 to 2000. He is also a distinguished fellow and head of strategic affairs at the Ananta Aspen Center. He has served two terms on the National Security Advisory Board to the Prime Minister of India from 2011 to 2015. Our esteemed panelists for this session are Mr. Harshvardhan Shringla, Foreign Secretary to the Government of India. In the course of a diplomatic career spanning over 36 years, Mr. Shringla has held a variety of positions in New Delhi and abroad. He has served as India's ambassador to the United States of America, the Kingdom of Thailand, and as High Commissioner to Bangladesh. He has also served in other diplomatic assignments, the UNESCO in Paris, the United Nations in New York, and other assignments in Vietnam, Israel, and South Africa. Mr. Shringla has previously served as Joint Secretary, Director General responsible for Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Myanmar, and the Maldives. He has also headed the United Nations Political and SAARC divisions in the Ministry of External Affairs. Dr. Anoop Vadhavan, Commerce Secretary in the Department of Commerce, Government of India. He has served in the Departments of Economic Affairs, Financial Services, and Commerce, as well as the Prime Minister's office. He has worked for the Water and Sanitation Program of the World Bank, providing technical assistance for enhancing accountability in water supply and sanitation service delivery through policy, institutional, and utility reform. He was a member of an African Development Bank team that evaluated its lending to the public utilities sector in Ghana and Tanzania. He holds a doctorate from Duke University, master's degrees from the Delhi School of Economics and Duke University, and a bachelor's degree in economics from Hindu College, University of Delhi. Over to you, Mr. Chaudhary.
Hello, everyone. We're still waiting for my two panelists to come, but we will begin with the Foreign Secretary, Ambassador Harsh Shringla, and we are expecting him to join us any moment now. And there he is. Mr. Foreign Secretary, can you hear me?
I can hear you, Pramit. Thank you, and good evening.
Good evening. I'll begin immediately with, since we've all been introduced earlier. So Ambassador Shringla, I'll begin since we are looking at this arguably the most contentious relationship, but also in many ways the most important for us in our immediate area, is that of China. We've had a set of border clashes. We now have the beginnings of a disengagement from that. But we have also, India has imposed certain economic actions against China. But nonetheless, China remains our number one trading partner, and it's obviously a country that we cannot avoid to not work with. Where do you see the trajectory of the Sino-Indian relationship right now? And I understand, obviously, that you're in a very sensitive time right now, so there's a limit to what you can say, but I'd still possibly like you to give some idea where you think that's going to be going.
Well, let me begin by saying what a pleasure it is to join you and my good friend Anoop Vadhavan for the Asia Economic Dialogue hosted by the Pune International Center. You started with some of the easy questions, I must say, Pramit. But let's see what we can do to put this in perspective. You know, I mean, as Anoop will tell you, China is one of our, it is actually our largest trading partner in terms of goods. We did about $78 billion in terms of bilateral trade. Of course, you know, the balance of trade is very much skewed in favor of China. we've carried a very quite a heavy trade imbalance over a number of years. Over time, this is increasingly, you know, seemed as being unsustainable. Now, of course, that is the trade side of it. We've also had, as you're aware, recent disturbances on our border areas in eastern Ladakh. We, in our interactions with our Chinese interlocutors, have always made the point that, look, a normal bilateral relationship is contingent upon peace and tranquility in the border areas. This is a sine qua non, and this is something that both sides have accepted as part of our treaty obligations. Now, as we disengage and as there is some forward movement in, you know, let's say, resolution of some of the border, recent border friction points that we've seen, obviously, we have to see what else is required. It is a very long border that we have with China. We are only talking about one small point on the border. We are trying to now see whether we can apply similar principles in sorting out some of the other areas which are in that in the Ladakh sector, some other sectors that we are talking about, and to see how else we can move forward on the issue of managing a long but contentious border with China in a manner that is you know, allows both countries to sort of maintain a level of you know, I would say, semblance of normalcy in whichever way is possible. This is a work that is in progress, that is ongoing. This is, as you mentioned, had an impact in a certain way on our economic relationship. There's also the other side of it with COVID-19, with a lot of restrictions in terms of flights, in terms of movement of goods, cargo, also a certain amount of, I would say, introspection and work on our part on making our supply chains more resilient, making them, you know, less dependent single sources. We are trying to see how we can diversify our imports, diversify our dependencies, and all of this is work in progress. But the important point is that, whatever you do, China is the second largest economy in the world. We have a large trade profile. Clearly, we have to continue to work on the economic relationship, but it has to be calibrated based on peace and tranquility and progress on important issues that are critical to both countries politically, and then of course the issues that Anoop will tell you about, which is basically the unsustainable levels of trade that is currently ongoing.
And a related subject, obviously, therefore, is what is going to be happening between us and the new Biden administration. Given that this is the Asia Economic Dialogue, I'd like to look at some of what we're starting to get a sense of from Biden administration in the United States. First, he is very clear that the Indo-Pacific is central to his foreign policy. We have seen him talk about that he wishes to see the Quad raised to a head of state, to a head of government level. There are reports now that they're looking at the idea of a sort of some technological alliances or coalitions, which would effectively be designed to reduce the influence of China, and also touch on what you've discussed, the issue of supply chain resilience. How welcoming are we to such ideas?
Well, we have to, when we see our relationship with the United States, there has been an element of continuity over a number of administrations, a number of presidents. The Prime Minister had a very close relationship with President Obama. He had a very close relationship with President Trump. He has had some excellent conversations with President Biden, whom he knew very well even earlier in his capacity as Vice President. When the Prime Minister addressed the joint houses of in Congress a few years ago, it was President Biden, who was Vice President, chaired that session. So there is a good rapport, and I think, as I mentioned, some good conversations between the two principals have already taken place. We have, as you mentioned, got a sense of the priorities of the new U.S. administration, which again, as you pointed out, has elements of continuity, the Indo-Pacific, the Quad. But also, I think there are new elements which the Biden administration has specifically spoken and outlined. One of them is an emphasis on climate change. The other is greater cooperation on technology, as you mentioned, technology, but also in addressing the challenges of COVID-19, which means not only technological collaboration linked to the health systems, not only between our countries, but also regionally and globally. And we are trying to work out various, the details of various proposals that have come in and which we are also keen to look at. But we are also looking at how we can, as you mentioned, make supply chain more resilient, how we can work together in the Indo-Pacific on areas that are of common interest, including COVID-19 response, including HADR, including maritime security, the entire range of areas where we can collaborate with the United States. But clearly, I would say there is both continuity and there is a sense of new initiatives that are coming in. And we have been receptive to all of these. We have also got our own ideas. But there's a very good discussion on these. And I think we are working at different levels, at the official levels. The External Affairs Minister and his counterparts just had a recent conversation, very good exchanges at all levels. And I think we will see more activity at the highest levels in the near future.
While they're not directly related to Asia, a continent, if you wish, where I've noticed the foreign ministry speaks of a new policy and a new approach. And this is obviously the Europe, which is, in at least the European Union in its entity, remains our single largest export market. But post-Brexit, a sort of new European policy seems to be being put together by our government. What are the elements of that? And does it have any, the number of European countries have begun to talk about the Indo-Pacific as well. How does that fit in with these larger geopolitical interests that we have?
Well, Europe is a very important partner. And when we talk about a multipolar world, you cannot consider that without Europe being a part of it. And we have obviously intensified our collaboration, our discussions with the European Union in recent times because of a number of factors. One, of course, is that COVID has been in many senses a game changer. It's necessitated a lot of countries coming together, who have a similar, who share similar values and principles, to look at how you can work together to minimize the economic and other, adverse effects of COVID-19, but also to work together on a positive agenda of, promoting, access, equitable access to things like vaccines, medicines, and so on and so forth. Europe is also important because of the post-Brexit era has made it important both from the point of view of their recalibrating their economic engagement with India, and also our looking at the UK as an important, partner in their own, recalibrations of their economic policy. We've had, again, both with the Europeans and with the UK, very good discussions. We have a very major engagement which is coming up, which is the Leaders Summit, which is the EU, the Prime Minister and the 27 leaders of the European Union states and the European Union leaders themselves coming together in Portugal in May. That's a very unique initiative in which our Prime Minister will be able to interface on a first-hand basis with the leaders of all European countries. There is a keenness and eagerness on the part of the Europeans to engage us. And we are looking at a range of areas across the board. Anoop will give you more details, but we are looking obviously at a limited or partial free trade agreement with wherever there are early harvest opportunities. We are looking at greater cohesion in terms of facilitating investments in each other's countries. We're looking at technology transfers, but in all of this, obviously Europe also has a people-to-people content which is important. We have between the European Union and UK 2.5 million persons of Indian origin, and that is an important factor to keep in mind. And again, we have very, very similar, India and the European Union and European countries have very similar outlook when it comes to a regional and global perspective, whether it is on issues like Afghanistan in our own neighborhood or issues like the Indo-Pacific, where increasingly, and I visited three countries in Europe, even in the midst of the pandemic, which were France, Germany, and the UK. And all three countries, I found, had a great deal of convergence with us on issues across the board, on strategic issues, defense and security issues, on trade and economic issues, and were keen to cooperate with us not only bilaterally but also regionally. And the Indo-Pacific is an important factor here, because I found that the French, of course, had a fairly well-established Indo-Pacific policy, but Germany had also come out with Indo-Pacific guidelines, and the UK was considering seriously Indo-Pacific participation. We've seen the Netherlands, we've seen other countries coming up with it, and we are working with the European Union to see if we can have certain elements of an Indo-Pacific strategy that can be considered as a common platform under which we cooperate and operate. But we obviously would like to see greater European engagement and involvement in our own region, and that is the basis of our, interest in involving them in the Indo-Pacific.
So I know one of the areas, I mean, you in your career, the neighborhood, if you wish, has been one of your specializations, notably our smaller neighbors, which, of course, Prime Minister Modi has put a special emphasis on in his neighborhood first policy. But sitting in Delhi, at least if you read the press, you would get the impression that working with these neighbors is often a sort of roller coaster ride up and down. And so we've had obviously great successes. The resolution of our primary border and maritime border disputes with Bangladesh, for example. But we've been having problems with Nepal. We have a few problems now with Sri Lanka, on and off. On the other hand, the vaccine diplomacy, the vaccine Maitri program, has had its greatest successes in the neighborhood. How would you assess right now where our relationship is with the smaller neighbors?
Well, I can, if you sit from our perspective and look at it, I think our neighborhood first policy has been very satisfactory from our point of view, because what is important is that you have a sort of a platform under which you cooperate with your neighbors. There are ups and downs that you experience, but that is to be expected between close neighbors and friends. I think it is important not to allow these issues that come up from time to time to allow it to be looked at in any manner as far as larger relationships are concerned. I think if you look at it over a period of time, we've had some excellent successes in our neighborhood. You mentioned about our comprehensively addressing the land and maritime borders with Bangladesh, a country today with whom we enjoy the closest of ties. You've seen that we had some very successful visits very recently of our external affairs minister, both to the Maldives and Mauritius. We are reaching out to our friends in the Western Indian Ocean. We've had, in the case of Nepal, I would say that even though we've had some issues that have cropped up of late, but at the same time, since then, we've had a number of areas where we have tried to work closely with the government, including the recent joint commission at the foreign minister's level. We've had good visits of the chief of army staff. My own visit to Nepal was very satisfactory from the point of view of meeting people across the board, getting very positive resonance on the way our Nepalese interlocutors see the relationship. I don't see that relationship going downhill. I think it is only going to be in a very positive trajectory from now onwards. You mentioned India and Indian-made vaccines. You have to keep in mind that the Prime Minister's vision, when he told the United Nations in September last year, he said we want Indian-manufactured vaccines to be made both affordable and accessible to all of humanity. And we've taken that very seriously. And if you've seen, within 40 days of that, beginning of our vaccine supplies, we have been able to send some 36 million doses of vaccines to countries all over the world, beginning with our neighborhood, but the Gulf, Africa, Latin America, the Caribbean. Now, if you look at our own neighborhood, on the 25th of January, that's the first day we had vaccines went to Bhutan, went to Bangladesh. On the 26th, we had it in Myanmar and Nepal, Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, and after that we never looked back. But today, when people all over the world are being vaccinated being immunized with Indian vaccines, I think that is something that is an important attribute not only to the success of Indian diplomacy, but Indian enterprise on the whole, that we've been able to use technology, use our use marketing, use the overall resources at our disposal, and share what we have with the rest of the world. You have to keep in mind that when we supplied 36 million doses of vaccines, we have done it without compromising our domestic requirements. It is only after taking fully into account what we need domestically that we have been able to, and whatever that we could was in by way of surplus has been exported. And when I talk about 36 million doses, 80% of this is commercially exported. In other words, only 20% of this quantity is by way of grants and aid to needy countries that required it. And I think that is also a very important part of vaccine diplomacy. Today, vaccines are, if you see immunization in Nepal, if you see it in Bangladesh, you see in Myanmar, it's completely Indian vaccines. You don't see any other vaccines. And this is, I think, and people want Indian vaccines. They, you know, there is a strong preference for Indian vaccines, and that has driven the entire campaign. And that, again, that is an important part of what we do, what our global interactions are all about, and our, what our neighborhood first policy determines. When you say sabka saath, sabka vikas, sabka vishwas, this is a very important attribute of this, that Indian-made vaccines are today being used by all our neighbors and by people all over the world. And we'll continue to make sure that we spare whatever quantities of vaccines we can spare will go out, will be used for the benefit of humanity, and that we will be an important factor. As Prime Minister Trudeau said of Canada, he said, if COVID vaccine is, COVID pandemic is contained, India will have a large part of that effort. And that's what we intend to do. We intend to play a positive global role for all of humanity.
So, this, I mean, this is a Pune-centered dialogue. So recently, of course, and Pune in many ways is the center of vaccine production in India, which we should flag. But the head of the Serum Institute of India did recently say that he was told the world, you'll have to wait a little while because I have to put India back on my priority list. Will that be slowing down what we are doing in terms of vaccine exports? And a related subject, which you've mentioned about the fact that there's a preference for Indian vaccines, do you feel that there is enough recognition in the publics of various countries, let's say in Africa, that what they are receiving is coming from India?
Well, certainly. I mean, Pune is an important center both of technology and industry, and the Serum Institute is based in Pune. We've had very close cooperation with the Serum Institute in our overall vaccine drive, both within the country and abroad. But as I said, I mean, you know, our priority is very clear. It is our domestic requirements that get first priority. It is after those requirements have been satisfied. In other words, as we increase our vaccination program, we must make sure that enough quantities are available in our country. Recently, we've announced that private hospitals can, undertake the immunization program for COVID-19. And I think the quantities would increase. But at the same time, our domestic capacity is increasing also. Both Serum Institute and Bharat Biotech have ramped up their production. By April, we expect a number of other vaccine candidates to get their emergency use authorization from the regulators. Once they come into the market, we will have larger quantities. I was recently in Russia when we spoke about the collaboration with Sputnik V. They intend to manufacture a large quantity in India for export to other countries. We are looking at significantly ramping up capacity. So while our domestic requirements will increase and will definitely involve larger, more categories, so the numbers will be greater. But at the same time, we intend to have significantly enhanced capacities within the country to ensure that our international obligations are also met. And as I said, we are working with many of our other partners. You will see some initiatives that would be coming in take that collaboration to the next higher level. But clearly, we will not compromise on the requirements both domestically and internationally. You spoke about whether countries are recognizing that they're receiving Indian-made vaccines. I don't know if you saw a clip by the president of Barbados, it was a short clip, but he essentially said that, you know, without Indian-made vaccines, we would have been in a very, very difficult position. He was extremely grateful to India, in particular our Prime Minister, for having supplied vaccines to a small country, which is, you know, right in the Caribbean, but had got, you know, some 50,000 or 100,000 doses of vaccines. And for a small population, that was a lifesaver. Similarly, I think we have seen such messages of gratitude and also, I would say, a sense of, you know, the fact that India has once again come to the rescue from countries all over Africa, the Gulf, our own region. And I would say that while we are not specifically looking for these messages, but I think these are spontaneous messages of gratitude to the Indian people for really sharing what today is a very scarce commodity. Very few countries have allowed export of their vaccine. And if you see globally, no country has really allowed that quantity of vaccines that we had to go out. It not only means that we, you know, it not only indicates the generosity of the government and people of India, but also I would say that it indicates our unrivaled position as a leading vaccine manufacturer. When you talk about global supply chains, you talk about health supply chains. When it comes to the requirements, then India is clearly right up there. And this is a prime example where Indian industry, Indian enterprise, Indian technology and Indian scientific endeavor have combined to give us a position of global stature and importance. And we've come really in a post-COVID world. We have created a space which is very unique. The other day I met, and I don't want to quote a private conversation, but the ambassador of Nepal had come to meet me. And he said that, you know, power doesn't have to be, it can be, you know, the soft power that India has exhibited by giving our vaccines. People in Nepal are really grateful for your vaccines in our country, that you have really shown that you have the capabilities of a global, you know, standing. And I think that he said that genuinely. And I think this is, I'm trying to give you a sense of the thinking and the receptivity that we gauge from all over the world in that regard. In particular, our own neighborhood, that's very important.
Well, Ambassador Shringler, before I let you go, I'll just ask you one last thing. This is still the beginning, if you wish, of a new year, and hopefully a year in which the pandemic begins to recede, and we're going to see a return to, should we say, normal diplomacy. And I believe the Prime Minister will soon be making his first physical overseas trip. What should we be looking forward to in this coming year as far as Indian diplomacy is concerned?
2020, in many senses, in diplomatic terms, did not allow the normal engagements that we have. In 2021, we will have a significantly enhanced level of engagement, but we will not reach normal levels that we've seen before that, before COVID pandemic came into our lives. But this year we do have plans, and as you mentioned, in March, the Prime Minister will be visiting Bangladesh. He's been invited on a very special occasion. 26th of March is when Bangladesh declared freedom from the Pakistani oppression. Prime Minister will be going there a day after Genocide Day, which is celebrated on 25th March. These are landmark occasions for Bangladesh. They have invited the Prime Minister because it is a part of our shared histories. India has been a very, very important part of that movement that created an independent state of Bangladesh. It will be an important event and one that both the Prime Minister and Prime Minister Sheikh Hasina is looking forward to. After that, as I mentioned, he'll be going to Lisbon, where Portugal will be hosting, as the chair of the EU, the leaders summit between the Prime Minister and the 27 heads of state and government of the European Union. He's also scheduled to visit the UK in June for the G7 summit, which we've been invited as guests. Again, in a very important engagement that we have. And then after that, I'm sure there will be other engagements that would be on the calendar, which we haven't taken a final call on. But clearly, we will see more activity. We will see, in many senses, post-COVID, consultations friends and partners would need to do to see how we can pick up the threads, we can contribute both regionally and globally into making the world a better place. A lot of lives and livelihoods have been lost. It's been a devastating pandemic. I think the international order has not seen this level of devastation since the Second World War. The Second World War created its own new order, and I am sure the post-pandemic world will also create a new order, but this new order will have India as an important part of it. I have no doubt about it, and you know, the Prime Minister's vision and the government's perspective on this is also clear, that we intend to engage in a manner that is constructive. You recall, just going back very quickly to the G20 summit, which India had initiated at the PM's initiative, in which the Prime Minister pointed out that the G20 as a group had always met only on economic and financial issues. This is the first time the G20 was meeting on a humanitarian issue. And I think this is important because the G20 set the stage for very important economic decisions, including the rescheduling of debts, which did impact on countries all over the world, particularly the most needy, the least developed, developing countries, I think, were very very much required that level of support in the, given the economic devastation caused by COVID-19.
Thank you, Mr. Foreign Secretary. Can I now turn to Dr. Vadavan, the Commerce Secretary? So I believe you want to give us a survey of the present state of our trade negotiations, which I know is a sort of a negative story as far as anybody seems to be concerned. In the past few years, we pulled out of RCEP. We've had to put our EU negotiations on hold. We've now, the mini trade deal with America has also been scrapped, but I presume you have a better story to tell us.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chaudhary. I'm delighted to be here for this session with you and my old friend, the Foreign Secretary, Mr. Shringla, and of course, the very distinguished audience, I'm sure, which might be hearing us. To be honest, I've taken your subject for the session quite literally, India as a global partner. So let me give you my thoughts on that. And you have seen it in the perspective of FTAs. We can come to that too. Let me just give you my broad thoughts on India as a global partner. I think you can see this issue from different perspectives, an economic perspective, a strategic perspective in a geopolitical context, a socio-cultural perspective. I think Harsh has touched on the strategic aspect quite significantly, and of course, to some extent on the economic aspect. Let me focus on the economic aspect. Let me say at the outset, notwithstanding, you know, whatever skepticism or pessimism we might have about FTAs and things like that, India's economic imprint across the globe is significant. We are a significant economic partner which cannot be wished away. Significant in terms of, you know, the absolute level of achievement today, and I concede more importantly in terms of the potential we still have to achieve. Now, to the extent we are below our true economic potential and we are endeavoring to get there, this imprint is certainly, you know, below its ultimate potential, but it is significant in many ways, as I will just elaborate. You know, let us look, for instance, at goods trade. If I can, you know, define the economic imprint broadly as engagement in goods and services trade and investment, then let us look at goods trade first. Now, our performance on, you know, merchandise exports is often seen as deficient, you know, below our true potential. But look at the qualitative aspect of our goods trade. I think Harsh mentioned our role in the pharma area, our role now in the supply of vaccines across the globe. Huge impact. If you see the crisis during the COVID period, there was a crisis of food supplies across the globe, and you saw India stepping up these food supplies. And in fact, during the COVID period, even though our overall exports fell, our food exports rose. They rose significantly. So here, this is a not often recognized aspect of our performance during the COVID pandemic. And then, of course, we look at, you know, other areas like engineering products, you look at gems and jewelry, you look at the role of our electronics exports increasingly. You know, for instance, engineering products, I was talking to someone who works for this institute where that in CERN, where that Hadron Collider is, and they tell me that that's a one of its kind installation and the parts are not available off the shelf anywhere. And whenever something breaks down, they think of India as a source for that particular part getting fabricated. You have some, bright foundry entrepreneur somewhere who will make that part for you. So even though in a quantitative sense, our exports, merchandise exports are not at the level where they should be given our capabilities and potential, the qualitative impact is huge. Let me look at services. Now, IT, for instance. Now, India is synonymous with IT in the West. Huge contribution to enhancing competitiveness of companies across the globe. Huge contribution to creating jobs across the globe. Small core team of Indian, IT professionals creating manifold increase in, local employment. And this IT will, give way to the industry 4.0 kind of IT work. And sometimes here again, skepticism is conveyed by people that, we are too manpower oriented in our IT services. We are going to miss the bus on the new areas of artificial intelligence and, the Internet of Things and what have you. But, my contention is that we are fast adapting to that. And to the extent we are filling that space today, we will fill that space when it transforms tomorrow. There's no reason to see why India will not fill that space, which, Industry 4.0 will offer, because the underlying foundations are the same. It's the same IT foundation which we are strong at. Then if you look at, our economic imprint across the world in terms of contributing to skilled workforce across the globe, look at the Gulf area, you look at, even countries like Singapore, you look at Europe, huge contribution of skilled, semi-skilled Indian workforce. Even Europe, it's not a very well-known story that, picking of their agriculture crop, Parmesan cheese in Italy. I was seeing a program where Parmesan cheese is produced predominantly in a particular Italian town. Significant part of the workforce is Sikh from India. So huge impact across the globe. Then look at, our managerial talent, look at our engineering talent, look at our scientific talent visible across the globe. Google headed by an Indian, Microsoft headed by an Indian. If you see our management pool in countries like Singapore, Dubai, go across the world, you see Indians breaking the glass ceiling. NASA, an Indian face will crop up. Any sort of interaction around medical issues in the West, an Indian face will crop up. So what I'm saying is that our impact on the economic dimension across the globe is huge. The qualitative impact is much huger than the quantitative aspect, where I concede we are below potential, but then we are getting there. And, you look at our remittances, for instance. Remittances, very strong, huge contributors to, bridging our current account deficit, and, combined with the capital account surpluses, we've been staying afloat on the external sector. So that all those are indicators of that economic imprint abroad, and all those are indicators of India being a significant economic partner for the world, which cannot be wished away. And I again concede that the best is yet to come in the future. And for that, we need to, if I can use a strong term, overcome our deficiencies in the domestic, investment environment. And to the extent we are underperforming as a manufacturing nation, to the extent we are underperforming as a exporting nation, the reason lies in the fact that we need to create a more attractive investment destination domestically. And that again is something which we have been endeavoring to do. If you look at the entire ease of doing business area, last 5-6 years, huge improvement in the approvals environment. We've made it online, digitized, paperless. And now an increasing effort in improving the physical environment, the virtual environment for approvals must go hand in hand with improving the physical environment on the ground in terms of, providing a plug and play platform that is land-based, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of logistics, in terms of a utilities environment that is world-class. And you see, this reform cannot happen at an economy-wide level. At an economy-wide level, you can't suddenly aspire for efficiency and achieve it. So you've got to create pockets of excellence. And that is what the world has done. You know, China created its pockets of excellence in the SEZ, where they mimicked the best environment in the world, even though China, on the whole, was not a developed nation or a nation free from various distortions and, you know, cost inflating inefficiencies. Yet they created a pocket of excellence which grew slowly to dominate the economy. And increasingly, other countries have done the same. Vietnam has done the same. And this is our focus in India also, create pockets of excellence where you give a world-class plug-and-play investment environment, whether it's for infrastructure, the logistics linkages, or the utilities, power, water, or a single window, a decentralized single window associated with that land-based platform. The SCZs were one effort in that direction. Around 2000 or so, we focused on that endeavor. It has not sort of delivered the kind of results we expected. We need to overcome those difficulties. And I think if you look at our initiatives for creating industrial clusters, industrial zones, if you look at the Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor with its industrial cities, all these are efforts in creating a world-class pocket of excellence where you can offer the best terms for investors. The PLI schemes, they are all in line with that. To the extent your environment is still high cost, has some unattractive aspects for investors, you overcome that lack of attractiveness by giving the PLI incentives. That is the way the world has done it. Vietnam has done it. And you can turn the corner very quickly. That's the other example which, you know, countries offer. You can turn the corner quickly. And, you know, Vietnam has turned the corner in a matter of 5-6 years. China, when it started moving on a much, much larger scale, a scale which I think India has to deal with, they also turned the corner quickly. So I'm very confident that we have the huge underlying strength and capability to turn that corner, and then it'll be self-sustaining. And I know there have been occasions in the past when you thought you'd reach that point of self-sustaining growth. I think late 90s, early 2000s, at least I thought that we were now at that point of, you know, self-sustained growth where all your bottlenecks and constraints you'd overcome, and you had acquired the confidence to rapid growth year after year. Of course, that was belied to some extent, but I'm confident that we will turn the corner through all these efforts, and we will do better than all these success stories we talk about and achieve our true potential. So that is what I have to say. Now you can pose all the tough questions you want to ask me.
So, well, we'll begin with, you mentioned the point about attracting investment as part of the means to make us a trading power, that you bring in the investment, I presume that brings us, locks us into the supply chains, and that ensures that we become exporters, or we become part of that export story, as well as reducing presumably our imports. However, this requires for the exporters and the supply chains as a whole, because supply chains, as you know, can run through several countries, and they need stability. They need, one of the reasons Vietnam has succeeded, or even Thailand as exporters, is because they've been able to provide FTAs, free trade agreements, and should we say surety of market access. So they've combined their trade diplomacy with their investment. Are we doing the same?
Yeah, see, certainly if you look at the area of FTAs, you know, it's very important. It's important for putting some kind of competitive pressure on your industry. Without competitive pressure, there is generally no inclination to reform. We saw that in the pre-1991 era. You had complete protection, and it didn't lead to any efficiencies or growth. So I cannot underrate the importance of FTAs for creating competitive pressure, for access to global markets, as you mentioned, for access to raw materials, intermediates, capital goods on competitive terms. And we haven't done too badly. You see, if you look at FTAs, we have 10 FTAs with many major countries. We have an FTA with Japan, we have with Korea, we have with the ASEAN, the huge bloc. So that's the kind of competitive pressure, and they're ambitious FTAs, you know, with around 80 to 90% liberalization of tariffs. So huge competitive pressure, 10 FTAs, 6 PTAs. So I don't see us as deficient. You know, you can't look at RCEP and say that, you know, we are not inclined towards FTAs or we've underemphasized them. I think we've done well on the FTA score. And of course, all FTAs take time. If you look at the TPP also, it took, I think, more time than RCEP took. And RCEP again, because India was a part of it. RCEP also, it was a contentious negotiation, took time. And that is one of the reasons why, you know, some of our negotiations have not sort of met with success yet. You might be thinking of the India-EU sort of FTA that we were negotiating, but I'm sure, you know, we'll overcome all those hurdles which are there in any FTA. You know, if there is no friction in an FTA negotiation, then there is no gain also. The gain is coming from the friction points, you know, where the other side is gaining and you have a sensitivity, you concede something, and then where you are gaining, the other side might have a sensitivity, and that friction in the negotiation, which takes time sometimes, is the source of the overall mutual gains that accrue ultimately. So I'm quite confident that, you know, we'll, to the extent we think of RCEP as a bit of a setback or a hitch, because RCEP, I think we took the best decision in our economic interest, because these things are not, you know, always things which happen by the rule book. There is more to trade than adherence to rules in many circumstances. And I think we had to be conscious of that. And we took a certain decision in our interest in the, as far as RCEP goes. But that has, you know, given us a stronger resolve to make progress in these other areas. To the extent you see things heating up on the India-EU front or the India-UK front, India-Australia, India-Canada. To a large extent, it is reiteration of that resolve we've had for a long time on the importance of FTAs. And RCEP, in some ways, has reinforced that resolve. So that's my
yeah. So anyway, RCEP is yesterday's story, except that. But what about what we're looking into the future right now? So we have, we're trying to negotiate a new FTA with the post-Brexit UK. There was talk during the last few months of the Trump administration of us holding some sort of a data dialogue with the US Trade Representative's office. And I think a lot of the new sort of new style FTAs that we are trying to accomplish focus on services, include immigration, perhaps for the first time. But at the heart of it, what we have as the incentive, of course, is the desire for countries like the US and the UK to have an understanding on the cross-border regulation and flow of data. Because in many ways, the future of international trade is going to be about data. Are we ready for that? What are the kind of parameters that we are looking for in such agreements?
Yeah, no, I think we are certainly ready for that. You know, you mentioned about our interests in services, and I think you alluded to the mode four interest in terms of movement of professionals. Now, we shouldn't, you know, confuse that with immigration. This is a temporary movement of professionals. To the extent someone immigrates ultimately to a particular country depends on that particular policy of that country. So it is not as if, you know, the temporary movement of professionals opens the door for immigration. It is only to the extent those countries want a permanent workforce of that nature. For instance, look at Singapore. You know, Singapore took a conscious decision to be an IT power, to be a center of IT related activity. So all these Indian professionals who were moved there temporarily to work in Singapore, Singapore wooed them as per their policies and, you know, virtually thrust those permanent residencies on them. So it is not as if we have an interest in immigration. Our only interest is that any economic relationship requires professionals to be able to move. Even goods trade, let us say goods trade, you're buying a turbine from someone. The turbine is a good, it comes here, it has to be installed, you need people for installation, you need people for training, you need people for any problem solving as it goes into operation. So let us say India imports turbines and then puts a roadblock on movement of professionals. That is something, you know, the country supplying turbines will never accept. Similarly, services. Now, services, especially IT, bulk of it happens in an offshore mode. It happens in mode one, where you supply the service electronically across borders, or it happens in mode two, like, you know, medical value travel. Some fellow comes from abroad and gets treated here, or tourists come. And to some extent, it happens in mode three. Mode three is investment-based. So to the extent you're supplying IT services to the West, you need some establishment there also locally to meet the requirements of that service being provided. So you have some investment there. And to run the investment, you necessarily need some core people from here. That brings in mode four. So some core professionals need to move temporarily. So all we are saying is that you cannot have an economic relationship that does not allow professionals to move when required. And to the extent a country takes commitments in goods, country takes commitments in services from mode one, mode two, mode three, and then keeps a hold on mode four, that, you know, whenever we please, we'll block this flow of our professionals and make it difficult, as countries have done. If you look at the entire H-1B sort of evolution, it becomes a barrier to trade in services. So all we are saying is give us the minimal commitment that you will not turn that tap off. Our companies, let us say, invest a huge amount of money in the US, create a lot of jobs, and then suddenly you find that your professionals can't move easily to service your investment there, to service your clients there. You have a million restrictions. This happened to some extent briefly in Singapore also. It is detrimental to the interest of that recipient country, of course, but more so it is detrimental to the business interests of people who invested time and money in that business. So our demands on mode four are very minimal. All we are saying is don't let that become a barrier when some professional needs to move there to take care of the larger economic relationship that gets established. That is all we are saying. And the answer we normally got is that, why do you worry about that? That is there in our policy. It will never be turned off, which is, of course, not always true. So you need not worry about that. Let that not be in the agreement. Let everything else be in the agreement. Let tariffs going to zero be in the agreement so that you can never bring them up again. Let all other commitments be permanent, but let this commitment, you know, be subject to domestic policy. So that is what we've complained about at times, but we are pragmatic. To the extent, you know, countries have concerns about that, we are not going to overly force the issue. You mentioned data. Now, you see data, now there's an increasing acceptance that data issues involve ownership. Data issues involve privacy. Data gets generated in the course of business, sometimes in the course of business engagement, through individuals taking part in that business transaction. Your data becomes privy to known to some entity, business entity. It has an identifier, your name, etc., with it. To that extent, it is private data. You are technically the owner of that. The company which acquires it should not benefit from it economically or otherwise without your permission. To the extent that private data gets anonymized, it is community data. So there is an ownership question there. Is Google or Facebook the owner of that community data, or is the community the owner of that data? Is the community represented by the nation state? And increasingly, countries, if you look at the EU law also on the issue, they recognize the importance of ownership, they recognize the importance of privacy. And that is exactly what we are saying, that data flows have to happen for services trade to happen, especially in mode one, you need data to travel, but then it should be with a clear understanding of who owns the data, how it can be used, and how privacy has to be protected. And if you look at the EU law, and our law is broadly, you know, in that direction, it is in the pipeline. So I don't think data will be an issue also. Because the world today recognizes that data flows must happen for business to happen, for trade to happen. At the same time, whoever becomes the recipient of the data must honor ownership, must honor privacy. And the entire, you know, the GDPR of the EU based on that premise, and I see no reason why we can't fit into that paradigm.
Well, keep in mind, the EU has failed miserably to create any commercial companies of note on the basis of the internet. They do not have Amazon, they do not have Google. And that's one of the reasons, is because of their data policies. Presumably we have ambitions to be otherwise. But anyway, let me ask you another question, since another future problem on the trade front is going to be carbon tariffs. Carbon-based tariffs, the EU plans to introduce them this year. The Biden administration plans to follow suit. Are we ready for that? And how do we? What is our position on the issue of carbon-based tariffs?
Yeah, you see, those are typically non-trade issues which are coming into the trade domain. So we always, you know, opposed trade issues getting mixed up with non-trade issues, and especially non-trade issues becoming a lever for, you know, achieving your trade interests. You know, let us say you impose a tariff on Indian products on some environmental grounds, or for that matter, products of any country. So we have opposed it. We are at the same time very concerned on all these non-trade issues, you know, whether it is sustainability, environment, labor, all those non-trade issues, we are at the forefront, you know, whether it's climate change. So we are saying that you have to engage in on those issues on the right platform, in the right channel. You can't mix them with trade issues. And the world has evolved over time. You see, the West has evolved to their present levels of, you know, environmental protection, their present labor standards or whatever. They've evolved over time. You can't now expect the developing world to evolve instantly. They've evolved since the Industrial Revolution. And part of our comparative advantage lies in the fact that we are at a different evolutionary stage, whether it's labor, environment, you know, our macroeconomy will support lower wages. Lower wages are sustainable in our macroeconomy, you know, giving purchasing power parity issues and all that. Now to say suddenly that, you know, we must pay our workers the same wage as they do in the US. The US has imposed that to some extent in their agreement with Canada and Mexico. Now that is undoing comparative advantage. That is unnecessarily mixing a non-trade issue with trade. And it is not recognizing that countries will transform over time. You know, no one has transformed instantly, and you can't expect the developing world to forego its comparative advantage and instantly adjust to Western levels. So, you know, that is my thought on it. At the same time, there are important issues we need to engage in the relevant dialogue. You know, whether it's climate change or anything else, we need to engage in that particular dialogue and not mix it with trade and then make it a lever for undoing comparative advantage of developing countries and you know, furthering the gap, economic gap between the developed and developing world. That is all that it will do.
While I think that in principle that sounds very nice, we were not able to stop intellectual property rights from being introduced. Labor standards are part of the WTO. And I believe carbon tariffs will be introduced regardless of what our position is on that front. But so I think we should keep that, be a little realistic about what we can stop. But having said that, can we go back to what I
began? Let me say on that, just one more thing. Certainly, you know, if something evolves in a certain way, then we will sort of do what is necessary to maintain our competitiveness and to create a level playing field, you know, that game can be played both ways. So certainly, you know, we'll do what it takes to be competitive and to create a level playing field for our manufacturers, exporters. Yeah, please go on.
So no, I mean, going back to give you a similar question as I gave to the foreign secretary, the end of the year, this coming year, what will we be seeing? What are you optimistic about in terms of actual tangible trade agreements. We're negotiating one with the UK. How far are we gone, or how far do you, when do you expect some sort of resolution on that, or what are the obstacles? We have resumed the conversation with the European Union. Perhaps we shall do something again with the United States. But I believe we also want a review of the ASEAN, at least the first ASEAN agreement. So what is on your agenda this year, and where are you the most optimistic?
Well, certainly, I think I'm very optimistic about all these windows that you've been hearing about, whether it's India-EU, there's India-UK, the US, of course, then Australia, Canada. And you know, in many of these, we have an understanding on an early harvest where you, within, say, 6 months to 1 year, you have a sort of core agreement, core initial agreement that's a confidence builder and a confidence booster. And then within a expedited time frame, you arrive at the full agreement. So that also is on the card. So I see significant progress happening in these negotiations. And I see, of course, our sensitivities also that might, you know, pose a challenge. But then at the same time, I see a way forward on all of them. And I think we have the kind of comfort with all these partners to find a balanced way forward where your sensitivity and the other side's ambition can be balanced in a sustainable manner. So I'm quite confident you'll see some significant progress on all these fronts. The review, of course, you know, every FTA has a review clause. To the extent your FTA has some problems you discover in its working, to the extent you discover that some aspirations were not fulfilled by the agreement because of certain impediments, some non-tariff barriers, to that extent you need to review, or to the extent some, you know, new areas of ambition have cropped up that you did not foresee earlier and you need to expand the scope of the agreement. So all these things require that review clause to be, you know, used. So review is an ongoing process, and we will certainly review our FTAs in this context to achieve their full potential and to address, you know, new issues and realities that have come up since they were signed.
Well, I think we're coming to the end of our session. Dr. Vadhavan, thank you for giving us both an insight into what's happening on the trade front, as well as some of the philosophical issues that underpin the Indian negotiating posture coming up. And with that, I'll hand it over back to the moderator.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Great talking to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you to our esteemed panelists who graciously took the time to share their insights with us. We also thank those attending for their attention and patience. The 8th and final session of the Asia Economic Dialogue 2021 will be on Asia's role in global currency realignment and financial flows. This session will begin at 7:30 p.m. Indian Standard Time. We look forward to all of you joining us then.